All right. So let me start by getting to know you a bit better. Who of you has sent at least one newsletter in his life? Okay, all of you. Who's using MailChimp? Okay, about half the room. Who's using something else? What are you using?
Webpower.
Okay, Webpower. Anything else? Okay. So regardless whether you're using MailChimp or anything else, all the things we'll talk about today will apply to any service you're using, so no worries if it's... I'll show you some screenshots for MailChimp, but you can apply the ideas to whatever tools you're using. But now to my main question here is, what's your biggest frustration right now when you're sending newsletters?
No response.
No response, okay. What else?
Getting subscribers.
Getting subscribers, okay.
Click rates decreasing.
Decreasing click rates, okay. What else?
Opt-outs.
Opt-outs. Okay. Any other ideas? Or is that like the main problems? Okay. So, what I quickly want to do with you as an introduction, I want to show you a few newsletters from your industry. I don't want to shame anybody, and I try to redact any logos or any CIs, but just go with you through those examples and see what you think, how good that newsletter is, and we can be completely honest here. So it's not to shame someone, but just to learn something and see how we can make things better. So, for example, this one here. It's just a screenshot from one newsletter. What do you think? Like, raise your hand if you think this is the best newsletter you've ever seen. Okay. Why not? What's missing?
Where's their call to action?
No call to action. Okay.
Lacking information.
Okay. What kind of information would you think? Destinations. Okay. Type of boats. Who thinks this is like it's okay like this? No one? Too much discount, okay. That's important, yeah. But who of you has sent something similar like this in the past? No one, you're all professionals. Perfect. I love it. Okay, this is another example. What do you think about this one here? Is it good? Is it bad? Bad? Why? Too much information, okay.
Main focus, not interesting.
The main four is not interesting, okay.
No point.
No point, yeah.
Message.
No message, yeah. I think that's the most important thing here. That basically, even if you like, I redacted numbers, but even if you look at things, it's just like properties of the yacht, and not about the experience you'll give your clients. Then another one here.
Again,
no call to action. So I mean, it's just a screenshot like from a longer newsletter. So there might be a call to action at the bottom, but it's a relevant pointer. A mixed message. How do you mean that? Like messed up, you know, yeah? To me, it also looks a bit like if you go into the city and there's like the stores today 30% off or 50% off. So you go in there because of discount and not because of what the store offers. So that's an interesting point here. Okay. How about this one? It's basically the end of the newsletter, as you can see here. Would you like to get a few of those emails over the month? No? Would you like to keep in touch? Why not? Not interesting, yeah? It looks more like spam or information you don't want to get, right? Even though you might be interested in the topic, but yeah. And who has seen a call to action? There's one. But it's almost not visible here, the book now on the left.
Down there.
So this is here, it's clickable. All right, last example. So I've redacted the numbers. You can see like the pixelated things. In there, you can find numbers like how much is it, when you can book it, how big is the yacht, and all the details. And then there's like a book button on the right, I think. What do you think? So basically, the newsletter just consists of this list. Boring, no message, yeah. Just pushing information out, yeah. Okay. So I think you're already quite good. I don't know why I'm standing here, because you really know most of the stuff we're going to talk about. And basically, I try to summarize like the main mistakes I see with my clients and in general in the newsletter industry to 5 points. And we'll go through these 5 points, and I'd like to discuss those 5 points with you. And then if we have time, we can tackle like all the questions as well if you want to. So the first point here is the sustainable marketing strategy. And I put in sustainable because newsletters is something which goes on over a longer time. It's not just you send out an email and people buy immediately. It's more like building a relationship over a year, over 2 years, until people are ready to buy or the offer is right. So this is like the first big mistake many make, that you think it's just like you send something out and you get something back, and it doesn't work like that. Next one is the right audience. So do you think like all these 5 examples were targeted to a specific audience, or was it just like, here's our stuff?
That's it.
Yeah. So there was no idea, no thought put into who exactly are we targeting. Is it, for example, families? Is it CEOs? Is it young people who want to have like a holiday on a yacht or anything like that? Number 3, the great storytelling. What you said before, there's no message. So what story do you want to tell? And in my opinion, just like saying, okay, it's this long and this, there's this height and there's like this property is not a story. But all of you have great stories to tell, and it's important to push them out. Number 4, I rarely see this actually in action, even with professionals. For example, MailChimp and any other service has lots of power when it comes to automation. We'll go into detail a bit later. But basically, having automatic triggers which send out emails automatically, responding on the behavior of people, and so on. And the last thing is incorporating feedback. And this is, in my opinion, the toughest one. If you just look at the emails, they always look the same. Always, always, always. And even if, we said before, like the click rates go down, if the opt-out rates go up, if the interaction with the newsletter go down, rarely people stop and think about like how they can adjust what they're doing. And there are some great tools where you can see what you can improve, but not too many people take that into account. We'll have that as a photo later on, so you don't need to write it down. But we go into detail now. So this is how it normally looks. So basically, you just push out emails, and at some point they come up somewhere, and there's no structure, no strategy behind it. And what I'd like to give you an understanding with is that there should be a strategy behind your emails. So, for example, if the summer is your high season, then you should put a strategy to work that it produces the most results in the summer. That means thinking about like how many emails do you want to send. So, for example, start in September, October, and the last one goes out in July, August, maybe with some last-minute offers. But how does your sequence look like? How does the story you want to tell look like over the months? And it's not just the single emails, but it's the combined effort of all emails that make you buy. So for example, if you watch television or if you see ads, this is exactly how it works. You see the ad not one time, but you see it multiple times, 10, 15, 20, 30 times. And at some point, you're in a supermarket and you think about, oh, that yogurt I saw before, and then you buy it, right? It's rarely that you buy it on the first time. And normally you say it takes about seven contacts with your client until they're ready to buy. And you can take this I mean, it's not a rule, but you can take this kind of notion into account and think about like not having like the call to action in every email, but more like giving the people value seven times or six times, and then on the seventh, you include a call to action, for example. And you don't have to like to have the best strategy, whatever. It's just you have to go away from this, I'm sending out a single email with a single information, and more think about more like on a bigger scheme, on how does it work over the months, for example. And another thing is, lots of people are overwhelmed with email. So they get many emails over a day. I don't know how many emails you get per day. But you start, like, even when you're really busy, you start ignoring emails. So it's also the case that many people won't get your email. But then, for example, if they don't get, like, the third and the fifth email, does your strategy still work? And if you start to think about this, normally it starts to work when you think about in a longer scheme, so to say. Next one is the right audience. So let me ask you, like, who's your ideal audience? Who's your ideal buyer? And I know it's an individual thing, so.
Well, definitely high end.
High end, okay. So, for example, here we have like a high-end exclusive target audience. Who is a different one? We're all friends here, come on. Who's targeting families? Okay, a few. Who's targeting younger people? Nobody's targeting younger people. CEOs? Okay, companies? All of them? Okay. Who thinks that the targeting all of them is too difficult? Yeah. So that's an interesting notion. I mean, we won't talk about this right here, but because it's more like it goes into marketing strategy, but if you're trying to target everybody, it gets really, really hard to provide valuable information. Exactly. So you have to I mean, there are basically two ways. Either you structure your business in a way that you only target one target audience, for example, I don't know, families or businesses or whatever that might be, or you start to segment your target audience so that everyone gets the story he deserves. And the main problem is basically that if you log into your MailChimp accounts and you go into your audience, you'll see something like this. So basically, you have the email address, you have first name, last name, and then basically the standard information from the newsletter, and that's it. And then normally you send out an email to all of your audience because everyone should get it, right? And in my opinion, that's completely the wrong way to approach this. So let me ask you, like, who has an open rate larger than 5%? Just raise your arm, okay? Larger than 10%? Keep your hand up. Larger than 10%? 15? Okay. 20? 30? 50? 60? 80? 90? Okay, I'm the only one here. So It is possible to reach those open rates, but only if you start to segment your audience. And the main thing here is relevant information. So as we said before, you only read those emails which seem interesting to you, right? And all the other emails you start to ignore because why should I spend any time? But this is something you can easily do with MailChimp and any other software. And there are basically three tools you can use. Who has heard of groups, segments, and tags. And this is MailChimp terminology, but you can find similar words in different software as well. Who has heard of these things? Okay, who is using groups, segments, or tags? Okay, can I ask you what of those three are you using?
Groups and segments.
Groups and segments. Okay, you?
Segments and tags.
Segments and tags. Cool. And I think there was one hand. Oh, just tags. Okay. All the others, do you have any idea what these mean? No? Okay. So we go into detail of these things. So basically, these are three different methods of structuring and segmenting your audience. And I've also put them into the priority. So basically, groups the most important, then segment, and then tags. And we go into detail now. So basically, like in MailChimp, if you go into manage contacts, you can add groups. And groups are mostly public visible instruments to group your audience, so to say. So basically, you could even expose these groups to your audience and let them choose themselves. And I normally advise to use groups for things which are more or less static and won't be changed often. So for example, I put here interest as an example. You can think about like, okay, is this person generally a summer person or a winter person for me? Or is it interested in catamarans or yachts? Or is it interested in high-end or low-end? Or is it a family or is it a business CEO? These kind of things. So normally think about things which don't change that much. And mostly are static, and you can even let users choose themselves. So for example, I had a client of mine, there are two offices in Berlin and Munich, and wanted to target people in both Munich and Berlin. So they use groups, are you group Berlin, are you group Munich? And then the clever move was to expose that setting to the user. You maybe have seen like there's this preference or update your options tag if you open a like a plain MailChimp template. And with that, people can set up their own profile. But the cool thing was that people who went to Berlin for, let's say, 2 or 3 months, they could easily change the information they got themselves. So basically say, I'm going to Berlin for 3 months, and I want to get information off Berlin and not Munich because I'm there for 3 months. So at least that, this is something you should definitely think about using. Then number two, segments. You can find it actually in the same tab. If you go to manage contacts, you can find create a new segment. Segments are more like volatile information which changes all the time and is more depending on basically things that change quite often. So and you can even include groups in here. As an example here, I probably you can't read it here, but the first one says, for example, campaign activity is opened any of the last 5 campaigns. So for example, that's how you can target people with a high interaction and give them like a special discount, for example. The second one is contact rating is greater than 3 stars. In MailChimp, we have the 1 to 5 stars thing, which also reflects the interaction with your newsletter. And the third one is date added is after a specific date, which I put the 1st of October in here. And then you can, with this thing here, any, you can combine them as you want. So basically have like and, saying like it has to match all of the 3 conditions. You can say or like I have here, so it has to match only one. And then you can save that segment for later use. So one segment could be the best buyers of the last year. Would be one segment. And then you can target emails for those things. And the last thing, which is actually a quite recent addition of MailChimp, is tags. I know that other software had it before. And tags are individual things every subscriber has. And you can see it here in the upper right. If you go into the detailed view of your audience, you can also see it in the general overview. And tags are more like, let's say, identifiable characters of your audience. So for example, I've put here an example, attended the last event or generally attended the event or bought product X, stuff like that. So you can basically store things like, did book a yacht of that size in the last year or something like that. And all of these three things you can use, I'll show you later on, to target the specific events to exactly those people. Just one note, I don't know if, like, many people seem to ignore those things. So basically, if you go into detail view of any of your audience members, you can find lots of automated information. So first of all, the groups we had before, the profile information, but also like what language do they speak, what location are they in, their favorite email clients, last updated, and you can also see like their activity to get a better idea and better understanding of what people are actually doing with your newsletter. And lastly, I just highlighted the top left. There are two things which could be interesting for you, the star rating. The star rating is, as I said before, from 1 to 5 stars, and it gets calculated automatically by MailChimp, and basically is a representation of how attached is that person to your newsletter. So basically things like how often does that person open your newsletter, how often does it forward, how much interaction is there, and so on. And they basically calculate that to a star rating, and you can just see it there. And then there's also like a special tag which is called VIP, and you can mark several people as VIP persons, and this might be interesting if you have like more an exclusive audience, a smaller one, you can target specific people as VIPs and you can use that information later on. And back to the beginning, so these are the three options you have to segment your target audience, and I suggest you to at least use two, maybe even three. And the segment thing is really, really interesting because you can create it on the fly and even use it for special email occasions, for example, so that you don't send the same email to all of your audience at the same time. And this is actually the way how you can increase your open rate and reduce your opt-out rate, because you give them relevant information. Next thing, merge tags. Who of you has heard of merge tags? Okay, one person. What are you doing with merge tags? Perfect. So basically, if you go into the settings of your audience, you can first of all define merge tags, and this is audience-based merge tags. So you probably, all of you, have the three standard fields, which is email address, first name, and last name, but there's the possibility to add many other fields and basically use MailChimp almost as your CRM. And here are just a few examples, text, number field, select buttons, dropdowns, date, birthday, address, phone number, website, and image. And you can use all of those information for your clients. You can choose whether to fill it out yourself, or when people subscribe, you can also offer to let them fill in their own things. But then MailChimp calculates these merge tags. And merge tags basically always look like this asterisk, then a bar, then a name of the merge tag, and then again the bar and the asterisk. It looks quite cryptic, but I can show you how you can use those things easily. And that's information you can use in your campaign. So for example, if you're here in the campaign editor, you can see that I used fname, which is just the merge tag for the first name. You can name them as you want. You can also put in first name or whatever you want. And then there's one field here, which gives you a list of all the possible merge tags you can use. And I think the most important thing is obviously all the merge tags from a specific audience member, like the first name or birthday or last name or address and so on. But as you said before, merge tags are also things like the unsubscribe here, the current year, current company, the list description, archive page, the rewards, and so on. Like all these things which automatically gets replaced by the actual setting are global things as well. And I'd recommend you to check out this cheat sheet. So if you go on this drop-down merge tags, you can open a cheat sheet, and MailChimp has many recipes to give you some examples how you can use it. So one, for example, we had before that the like most audience members have a language, and you can easily have two versions of the same email in different languages by basically just saying, if that merge text is English, then English text. If it is Croatian or German or whatever, I'll just put a different translation below. So you don't have to send out two emails, you can just combine it into one. But also, this hello first name is also a nice thing you can use. I'd suggest, though, that do not overuse those things, because people in 2009 kind of feel if it's automated or not. And if you put in hello first name, like hello Daniel or something, people kind of feel that it's not personal or not, and that it is automated. So be careful with those things, but can easily use that thing. Like, for example, it's a long time since you booked the, and then use a merge tag for type of product, for example, yacht or catamaran or something like that. Something like that could work easily. And then personalization. Who of you personalizes the emails he sends out? How do you do that, for example?
I'm not doing the MailChimp, though.
Mm-hmm. But your company does it. Okay.
Not sure how.
Not sure how, okay. All right. So this is basically the screen if you create a new campaign, and now everything comes into place. So first of all, you choose the audience, and I just create a new audience, Booking Manager Summit, but then here's segment or tag. And you can use the segments and tags we said before. So for example, these are the tags I've defined before, like attended event or bought product X. But you can also target by group, which is the second option here. There are pre-built segments, which are really interesting. So for example, new subscribers. So just send an email to new subscribers to get something started, to ask them, why did you subscribe, what do you need, something like that. But also active subscribers, like people who have high star rating, also very interesting inactive subscribers. So I've seen, for example, that you've not been reading our emails, can we help you? Is there anything you would like to have differently, or something like that? And then to re-engage with those people. But you can also create a new segment on the fly here. So that's what I said before with segments. Those are quite instantaneous, and you can just define any type of segment you want to have here. And then again, we have the same thing. Like, you want to have like any of those conditions, you want to have like all conditions, and you can just put in conditions you want. And with this, you can actually start to send out emails to just like, I don't know, 10 people, 50 people, 100 people. Really small batches, but you know that they will work because they are highly targeted at that target audience. It's not that here 30% off, please buy, but it's more like, hey, I know you're interested in that specific type of offer we have. Check it out, and we can help you with whatever. And that brings me to the next point, to the great storytelling. And basically, this is what I want to say is basically don't sell plastic, sell an emotion. So nobody wants to have like a yacht with like 15 feet and that size and that weight and so on. But it's more like I want to have a holiday with my family on a boat and I want to have a great experience. Or maybe a business CEO, I want to invite all of my business friends and we're going to have like a great time and maybe talk about the next project or next year or whatever. Or a group of young people, it's our first holiday together, something like that. And this is actually, in my opinion, one of the most important things. It's obviously not related to MailChimp, but more like think about what story can we tell? What's the value we actually bring to the table? And it's rarely the boat per se. It's always what people do with the boat. And that's the important thing. So for example, just start talking about other clients. So for example, they went to like a special route and had some great fun there and saw some dolphins, whatever. And then you just tell a story and yeah, try to match it with your target audience, basically. And the fourth thing is automation. So who of you uses automation? One? What do you do with automation?
Mm-hmm.
That's one perfect use case, for example. So automation basically means that you can set up emails which are sent out automatically later on. It sounds more complicated than it actually is. Basically, okay, it looks a bit complicated, but but it isn't at all. So basically, the automation always works on a trigger. So you define a trigger on which an email gets sent, and here are a few examples. So basically, a previous email was sent, or a link was clicked in an email, or a new subscriber just was added to the list, or anything like that. And you can use those things as a trigger, and then define a sequence of emails you can send to them. So for example, think about you sign up to a new email list, and you will get, for a week, for example, one email per day. Or over the first 3 months, one email per week, or per month, or whatever. And basically, you set up the first trigger here to send out this email, and then you see like there's some dots going down, and you can always set up new triggers. So for example, here we have the trigger immediately after subscribe contact joins your audience, that email gets sent. And then the next one is 1 day after that previous email was sent. But you can also choose like 2 or 3 days or whatever. You have some settings, for example, to schedule those emails, to say like, I only want to send them between Monday and Friday, or I only want to send them in evenings, or only on weekends, and so on. And then again, our great friend, filter by segment or tag, and you can also filter by those groups and segments, and so on. And also might relevant, but it's more like an advanced topic, the post-sending action. So basically, you can also say, add a tag if that email was sent. So for example, you can add a tag, he already had the introduction to our company, so we don't have to tell him that story again, for example. And here, just a few examples what you can do with those things. So I think you had birthday. No? OK. But basically, if you have the birthday of a client, you can just send him an email at that day, for example. Anniversaries, so if you store when he was booking a boat or when he had his last holiday, for example, you can just store the date and then send an email 1 year later and tell him, like, oh, it was one year ago since you had your holiday, remember, and send a photo or whatever. Onboarding sequence. That's something you had before. So basically, send them a few emails just after they sign up. A pre or post rental sequence. So for example, automate the information they need before they rent a boat. So for example, how to get there, what to bring, give them some insights about the boat, about the product, and so on. But also the post rental sequence. So ask for feedback, give them some say thank you, or any of those things you can easily do. Follow up on purchases, which is quite similar. So after people buy something, you can also send them automated emails. Reward your best customers, which again goes back to the star rating, or if you store it, like how much they bought, and send them a thank you note after that event, for example. Or even reach out to lapsed customers. So basically have an automation. If they're not clicking, not interacting for 3 or 4 emails, send automatically an email saying, hey, we didn't hear from you in such a long time. Is there anything we can do? Something like that. And these are just a few examples you can use, but it's really, really powerful, and most people seem to ignore the power they have there. And the last thing is incorporating feedback. So who's regularly looking at the reports? One, two, a few of those, okay. So who can tell me what these terms mean? Okay, hands up if you've heard at least one of those. Two, three, four, five, and all of them? Okay. Let's put it on around, like, who doesn't know at least one of them?
Yes, okay. Those are all campaign activities.
Okay. Should I explain them? Okay. So basically, these are all metrics every subscriber in your audience has. And you can see them in their individual profile, but you can also see them in reports. The first one is basically sent. So I sent on a campaign to that email address or to that audience member. That doesn't mean that person read it. It just means it was sent to the email account and it arrived. You don't know anything else. The next one is more relevant, which is it was opened. So you know that that person, even just for a second, had a look at your email. So even if they were just scrolling through, clicking on it, oh, not interesting, go on. It just means this email was opened. Next one, it was not opened. So basically, you know that they received it, but you don't know if they've seen it. And here, it might be interesting, I think in Outlook, in Gmail, you can disable images. And if you disable images, third-party things, and so on, people also fall into that category. So depending on their privacy settings, the open rate might be wrong. There are other things, like if you start to click on things, then MailChimp can track them again. But that number is not perfectly aligned with the reality. All the time.
So you don't really know.
It gives you an indication, but it's not the exact number, actually. Next one, clicked, means they clicked on any link in your campaign, even just the unsubscribe or the who is this or any image or link you have in that campaign. The bounced means that audience member did not receive your email. It was bounced back by their email server. And there are several reasons for this. And MailChimp makes a differentiation by soft and hard bounces. Hard bounces basically means we cleaned it, it's not existent anymore. Maybe that person has left the company and an email address is not active anymore, these things. And soft bounce is more like things which could go away. For example, the mailbox is full, or he's on holiday, or stuff like that. And unsubscribed is basically, yeah, that person unsubscribed from your email. Normally, you can't, like, if a person is unsubscribed, it still is in your audience, because you need to know that that person is unsubscribed and you can't send them emails, but it's still there. So do whatever you want with them. If it's a client of you, you obviously can still reach out to them on a personal note. Call them, for example, or send a personal email, but at least from mailing this perspective, you can't reach those people anymore. And this is normally how it looks like if you go into the reports. So basically, you have like a general reports image, which goes on the audience, gives you an idea like who your audience is, how big, and what their interaction with your mailings are. But then every campaign has an individual report, and then every subscriber has an individual report. So you can get a lot of information about how well your email was received. Here, for example, we already have like two of those terms. So the open rates, you can see it's about 50%. That means 50% of that audience have opened that email. And you can see about 10% have actually clicked on it. And then there's like this blue line here at about 18%, which is the industry average open rate. Remember when you signed up on your MailChimp account, it asks you what industry are you in? That was because they give you some further information if you're above or below the average. And you can actually see the open rate is quite low with almost 20%. Then if you scroll down, you can go into more details. So basically, this is the overview of a specific campaign. And you can see over 50% of your audience opened it, also like the average. So the audience average is basically telling you like over all emails you send out over the last year, it was about 48% open it, and now you're above average comparing to your own. But also industry average. Industry, for example, this example here was a computer company, and the industry there is 17%. So we're preferring a lot better than those are. And then on the right-hand side, the click rate, which is 2.4%. Industry average is 8.5. The audience average 8.5, and industry is 1.8. And I often get a question like, how important is click rate? And in my opinion, this is, for example, something you should have a look at, but then ignore. Because as we said before, it's not about single emails. It's about the collection of many emails. It's about the communication and the relationship you build up over a year or several years. So it doesn't matter as much if not too many people click on it. Obviously, it's good if they do, but if not, then nothing bad happened. And then we have like those other four terms. So basically, now in real numbers, 308 people opened it, 13 of those actually clicked on it, 3 didn't receive the email, and 6 unsubscribed. I think the unsubscribe number is quite okay. So basically 1 or 2% is a perfectly normal behavior from your audience. And you can also see that it was actually a quite small batch. So it was sent to 540 subscribers, targeted, so basically the list is much larger, but we decided to only send it to about 500 and based on segments, groups, tags, and so on. And then you can see the total opens actually higher than the audience with 640. Do you know why?
So they can open it twice.
Exactly. Every opening counts as an additional opening. So there are several people who open it several times, which will be important later. Last opened, also interesting, like how relevant is it? Because like, if the last opening date was just a week ago, but I sent the email a month ago, then people refer back to that email because they want to look up something. Also might be interesting for you. The right-hand side is the clicks per unique opens, total clicks, and so on. Forwarding normally gives a number if you have the forwarding merge tag in your email. We didn't have that there, so that's the reason why there's zero. So you can add a forwarding button to your email, and if you click on it, it opens a website, and you can add in a different email address. But I don't know how relevant that is, because if you're an email client, you can just click on the forward button, and that won't be counted. So that's how it works. Also important, the 24-hour performance. So what happened 24 hours after you send out the email? Normally, you always have like a line like this. But it's interesting to look at like what happened the day after, depending on like if you send it out in the evening, what happened the day after, and also gives you an idea of, for example, to think about like what's the best time to send a campaign for you. Because if you send it out in the evening, and almost no one opens it, and all of them open at 8 a.m. or 9 a.m. in the morning, then it might be an idea to move your date or your time to the morning. And then, lastly, you can't see it because it's too bright with the beamer, but basically, here you can see the links, and here you can see actually the actual names and of those subscribers. And those are actually really important, like the top links, if you have several links in there, but the subscribers most opens. So for example, I have one subscriber who opened that email 96 times. What does that tell me? that either he's stupid and just like scrolling your email, or that he's really interested. And I think the latter one is more likely to be the case. So that would be a perfect time to maybe pick up the phone and talk to him directly. Maybe like that. Depending on what business you are in, right? Like if you're working with CEOs, so like more like an exclusive audience, then yeah. If it's more like a family, something, just send an email and that's fine as well. And the last thing here, it also gives an overview. We said before, like every audience member has an automatic location in there, and you can see like most of the audience of that campaign was sent to people in the USA, Germany, and then a few other ones. Right, so to recap, if you just take one or two things out of there, your email marketing will be a lot better. And obviously, there are many of advanced topics, but if you just say, I'll start to think about like not to send out a single mail, but more like a sequence of emails over a year, for example. Also look at how long does it normally take to get a new customer? Like, when was the first contact and when did they actually rent a boat, for example? Normally, like, does it take 12 months, 18 months, or even just 3 months? And then you can optimize that sequence to that time frame, for example. The next one, the right audience. So, I mean, first of all, it's a business decision of who do you want to target, but then again, in your audience, start to segment group people into different categories, and then start sending emails to only those subgroups of your whole audience. Number three, think about like what stories you can tell. Stop sending out 50% off, please buy our boat, buy our service. But start thinking about like, yeah, as you said before, that family was with that boat and they've seen dolphins and been diving there, and here's a photo of them, and look how happy they are, and you want to be as happy as they are, so stuff like that. Obviously targeted to the audience, that's not something a CEO wants to hear, except he's on holiday with his family, then he wants to hear exactly those things. Number four, starts with at least one automation campaign, and the easiest one is just a welcome sequence. Think about like one or two emails you can send every new subscriber, welcome him on the list, show him some things, give him some value. Think about like maybe here are the top five things you need to know when you rent a yacht or boat, sailing boat, and so on. And just give him like a short list or something like that. And the last thing, start incorporate feedback. So start looking at the reports, the general reports, the campaigns. Don't take them as like, I have to obey, but more like, look at them, get a feeling, did it perform better, did it perform worse, what do I have to change, what can I change, and then try some small experiments and see if they perform better or not. And that's actually all I've prepared so far. How much time do we have left? We don't have time. Okay, then. Then I'll be around at the conference, so I'll be just walking around. If you have any further question, just come to me, and I'm happy to talk with you about your problem. Thank you so much.